This episode is brought to you by Squarespace. It's been 2 years since I installed solar panels on my home in the Boston area. How's it been going? Well, let's take a look at how much it cost, how much it saved, and how it's been holding up and what type of maintenance it's taken. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. You might not think that Boston would do well for solar production, especially since we're better known for our nor'easters than our sunshine. But you'd be surprised. I started looking into getting solar panels years before I actually got them installed in my home. They were still far too expensive and not efficient enough to make them worthwhile for my house when I started looking. But thankfully, the prices kept dropping and the efficiencies just kept getting better. Now, I've run through a lot of the details of my system in previous videos about this, but here's what's installed on my house. I've got 26 LG 365-watt panels that come with a 25-year warranty, which guarantees at least an 88.4% of its original power output. They're hooked up to 26 Enphase IQ6 Plus microinverters and are monitored by the Enphase Enlightened system. The total cost of the 9.49 kilowatt system before state and federal incentives was $29,609. Now, when I got this installed, the 30% federal tax incentive was still active, so I ended up getting an $8,882 credit applied to my taxes the year that we had this done. There's actually a lot of misunderstanding about how the federal tax credit works. It's not a rebate check that you get cut from some kind of fund. It's a credit that you can use to reduce your tax burden in a given year. If you aren't able to apply the full amount in 1 year, you can roll a portion of it over to a second year. Because most of us have our taxes automatically withheld from our paychecks, that means you'll have overpaid your taxes by tax time and will get a nice refund check for the difference. But it all depends on how much you paid in taxes. And the current program is winding down now and is currently at a 26% credit. In 2021, it goes down to 22%, and in 2022, it'll disappear for homeowners completely. But for commercial installations, it will remain at 10% forever. In the end, our system cost us about $20,727 out of pocket, or about $2.18 per watt for the installation. As I explored in a recent video, Tesla's current per watt pricing is much lower than that now in the US, which is about $1.49 per watt. We're still lagging way behind other areas of the world for our per watt pricing, like Australia and Europe, but that's where we are right now. Now, this is not a small chunk of change that I spent on the system, so why even do it? Well, my goals were pretty simple. I wanted to reduce my dependence on the grid as much as possible, try to get as much energy from renewable sources as possible, and to do it all in a way that was financially responsible. Energy independence, or as much as I could get, was very enticing. If your goal is to make a buck and that's all you care about, this isn't going to be what you want to do. And that's something I've heard a lot in the comments on my previous videos. But the people that wrote that I should have just invested this money clearly didn't listen to the goals that I had for my system. So how's it been performing and how much energy has it actually made and saved? But before I get to that, I'd like to thank today's sponsor, Squarespace. I've been using Squarespace for years and used it for the Undecided website. I've got over 25 years of experience building out websites just like this, so I know it's a full-time job to build and maintain one. Squarespace takes care of all of it and lets you focus on the other work that matters for your business. Now, I absolutely love the content management system for publishing my articles and videos. You can customize and fine-tune the look and feel to get something that really fits your personality and your company's brand. And you don't have to worry about software updates, web servers, or anything like that. The all-in-one platform is my favorite part. If you want to build out a beautiful web presence without the hassle, head over to squarespace.com for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/mattferrell to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Thanks to Squarespace and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now, the system got turned on at the beginning of October in 2018, which was a little anticlimactic because winter is the lowest production time of the year for us. That meant the monthly savings was only about $25 to $50 a month, or about 100 to 200 kilowatt hours produced per month. Nothing to write home about. But when you look at my system over the course of a year timescale, it's hit exactly where my solar installer predicted. The pattern you'll most likely see on systems like this will look like a sine wave over the course of a year. For me, my peak happens between June and July, and the lowest point is December and January. Over the course of the year, that's worked out to about 6,665 kilowatt hours for year one and 7,193 kilowatt hours for year two. And both years are above the guaranteed amount my installer predicted. My house is a less than ideal setup with a small roof sloped east to west. Having a southwestern facing roof in the northern hemisphere is far better to capture as much of the sun's path as possible. For me, I opted to put panels on both sides to capture as much of the morning and afternoon sun as possible. On top of that, my neighbors have some very tall trees on the western side that cause some shading in the late afternoon, so my production slopes off pretty quickly by about 4 p.m. I'm not sure if my neighbors would like it if I went out and cut down their trees. Not that I've dreamt about that. But like I said, less than ideal, but even with living in the northeast of the US and contending with a very small roof facing the wrong direction and shade, I'm covering about 60% of my energy use through the use of solar production. Now, I have friends in my area that are able to cover nearly 100% of their yearly energy use, which is why I always tell people that the only person that can determine if solar is right for you is you. So how did I figure that out for myself, and how does it look in practice? Well, you need to look at your energy use per year, how much you pay per kilowatt hour, and then compare that against how much a solar panel system is estimated to produce for your home and what it will cost. It gets a bit more complicated when you layer in different net metering systems, time of use rates, different incentive programs, loans. You get the idea. What I did was I tried to figure out our average monthly energy use costs and then start getting quotes and recommendations for different solar panel systems. I ended up using EnergySage to get quotes for myself. And if you're interested in going solar, I strongly recommend checking out EnergySage for research and articles. It's a completely free service that has great write-ups and reviews of different solar panel systems, inverters, and solar tech that can be useful no matter where you live. In full disclosure, I am one of their partners. I jumped into their partner program after a great experience using them. Now, if you live in the US and are interested in going solar, you can get quotes from installers by using my EnergySage portal. You can plug in your information and request quotes from installers, which are all funneled into your EnergySage account, where you can review them, and rather flooding you directly with phone calls or spam, it makes it easy to compare installers, cost estimates, and energy production quotes all in one place. It's a nice apples-to-apples comparison between installers. But even without EnergySage, if you want to break things down in an apples-to-apples way, be sure to calculate the cost per watt of each quote that you get. Just take the total out-of-pocket cost, and I'd recommend the cost after incentives, and divide that by the watt system size. So if you're having a 5-kilowatt system installed for, let's say, $7,500 after incentives, then your per watt installation price is $1.50. That's how I ended up with the $2.18 per watt pricing of my system in 2018 after subtracting the tax credit. The installer I ended up with not only gave me a very accurate estimate of yearly production, but he also guaranteed the production for the first 10 years and offered a 20-year workmanship warranty. And where we live, we pay between 22 cents and 24 cents per kilowatt hour and don't have time of use rates available to us. But we do have full net metering, so every kilowatt hour of overproduction that we feed into the grid is credited a full kilowatt hour off our bill. Not all states and utilities do it this way, so you may only get partial credit, unfortunately. Some areas will only credit the production kilowatt hour cost and not the delivery cost. You'll need to find out what your area offers as far as net metering and rates to calculate the final value of going solar. Since my net metering is 1-to-1, it makes the grid act like a giant battery for us, at least dollar-wise. If you average out our monthly production in dollar value over the year, it comes out to 556 kilowatt hours produced per month. Our average electric bill went from $212 per month to $90 per month after solar. That's a 58% savings. We're also participating in a Solar Renewable Energy Credit Program, or SREC. Here in Massachusetts, it's now known as the SMART program, but my rates were locked in under the previous system for a 10-year period. We get $126.22 per month for the energy we're producing, which works out to $15,146.40 over the course of the program. When you combine our electricity savings with the SRECs, we're saving a total of $248 a month for the first 10 years of the system. After that, it just drops down to just the energy savings alone. We got a solar loan to pay for the system, so we also need to factor in the interest cost to our final tally. After the tax credit, our total system cost us $20,727. But at the rate we've been paying off the loan, the final costs, including interest, will be around $23,250. But it might be a little bit lower. It all depends on how quickly we pay it off in the remaining months. But that means the system will have paid for itself by 2026, or 7 years after installation, which falls right in line where our projections were before installation. If we didn't have the SREC $126 a month credit and only had the energy savings alone, it would pay itself off by 2034, or 15 years after installation. The interest we paid on the loan added about 2 years to our payback time. And clearly this is a long-term decision that we made, and all the numbers I cited for myself will vary depending on your home's specific situation. I have friends in my area that had a payback period in under 4 years. My brother-in-law just had solar installed in his home in Texas, and it's incredible the amount of energy his system is producing. He's most likely going to cover 100% of his energy needs throughout the year, so he'll never have an electric bill again. But Texas also has cheap electricity already, and no real solar incentives at all. So his payback time might not be that different from mine without the SRECs. You have to evaluate the solar for your specific goals and situation. But what about the maintenance? This is another question I've heard a lot, like a lot, a lot. There are only a few things that I've had to do to my solar panels over the past couple of years. Within the first 6 months, we had two short periods where our panels stopped working for a few days. It turned out to be a faulty emergency shutoff switch for the system, so the installer swapped out the part and it's been humming along ever since. And this cost us nothing to fix. It's one of the reasons that our first year of production was slightly lower than our second year. The two other things I've done are sweeping snow off the panels after a heavy snowstorm in the winter, which really isn't necessary. You can do it if you want or not. Snow tends to melt more quickly on the panels than it does on the rest of the roof. And it's kind of funny to see it in my neighborhood because every house with solar is usually clear of snow within a day or two after a heavy storm, while everyone else has snow on the roof sometimes for weeks. But if it's anything over a few inches, I try to clear it off with a foam roof rake to give my panels a little extra help, and to also help control the avalanche of snow that happens when it slides off the roof on its own. It's kind of funny and a little scary when it happens. Now, like I said, not necessary, but if you want to maximize your production, it's not too hard to do. And then the second thing I do is using the same roof rake, but with a cleaning attachment, I've washed off the panels in the summer a couple of times. Again, in my area, it's not super necessary since we get a fair amount of rain that washes off the dirt and the dust and the pollen. But during dry periods, you can sometimes see that pollen and the dirt build up. Now, I haven't noticed a dramatic difference in production between it dirty and clean, but it can lower production if you let them get too dirty. Now, overall, I've had zero maintenance costs in the first 2 years and expect that to continue. Both the inverters and panels have 25-year manufacturer warranties, and my installer's workmanship warranty has me covered for 20 years. Based on that, plus everyone else I know personally that's had solar for years, this trend is going to continue for quite a while. The only up-and-coming cost, which I've accounted for but really haven't discussed on previous videos, is putting on a new roof. My roof still had a good amount of life left when we installed the panels, but I'm expecting to have to replace them all, or at least a portion of the tiles, in 10 to 15 years. For that, you typically would hire a solar installer to remove, store, and then reinstall the panels when the roof work is done. The cost can vary wildly, but according to Energy Sage, it can range between $1,500 and $6,000 depending on the size of the system and whether or not the mounting hardware has to be removed. From the people I've talked to in my area, I'd expect it to be somewhere around $3,000 for me, which means losing about 1 to 2 years worth of solar panel yearly savings. In the grand scheme of things, that's a drop in the bucket for the total savings of the system over 30 years, which should be over $30,000. And before anyone asks about battery storage, I didn't have batteries installed as part of the system originally. It didn't make sense financially with the cost and the fact that I have full net metering. But since then, I've earned a Founders Edition Tesla Powerwall from Tesla's referral program, and I've been waiting for that to get installed, and we'll be publishing a video on that experience and what I think of the system later, so be sure to hit subscribe and the notification bell to not miss that one. And I recently just published a video about home batteries in general, costs, benefits, and different incentive programs that are popping up. Depending on where you live, the math for battery storage is starting to make a lot more sense. So be sure to check out that one too. And jump in the comments and let me know if you have any questions. And if you have solar panels, how have they been working out for you? Share your experiences here because it can really be helpful for others looking into it. And as always, a special thank you to all of my patrons. All of your support is really helping to make these videos possible. A big welcome to new Supporter Plus members Ed and Suzanne Amos, and new producer James Aspinwall. And as always, thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.